Hello and welcome to High Voltages. In this video, we will explore the possibilities of using an ESP32 as an MQTT broker. We will discuss why you might need one and whether the ESP32 is a suitable choice. When choosing an MQTT cloud service, you have several options. Dedicated MQTT brokers, such as HiveMQ, offers a free and private MQTT cloud. Mosquito and EMQ are other popular choices. Cloud providers. You can also use cloud providers like AWS, Azure, or Google Cloud to set up your own MQTT broker. On-premises. For a private broker, consider running it on your laptop, desktop, Raspberry Pi, or even your phone. Some applications allow you to do that. But what if we have small number of devices which sends messages infrequently? All these private MQTT broker options will be overqualified and full-fledged MQTT broker might be overkill. For small-scale IoT projects with limited resources, the ESP32 can be an excellent choice as an MQTT broker. Its low-cost, small size, and low power consumption make it well-suited for resource-constrained environments. So let's find out if using ESP32 as MQTT broker as a reliable source. We will use the Pico MQTT library and let's look at feature of it. The MQTT library we are using is by Michael and supports both client and broker modes. In this video, we will focus on its broker functionality. This library supports MQTT version 3.1.1 and is known for its high performance, capable of delivering thousands of messages per second. It also supports connection over WebSockets, which are a technology that allows communication over HTTP. I have covered WebSockets in more detail in another video, so feel free to check that out if you are unfamiliar. The library can be integrated with Arduino JSON, making it more versatile for handling structured data. It's also designed to be memory efficient, making it suitable for resource-constrained devices like the ESP32. While the MQTT library offers many advantages, it has some limitations. As a client, it supports QoS level 0 and 1, but as a broker, it only supports quality of service level 0. Quality of service levels determine how reliable message delivery is. I have covered quality of service levels in more detail in another video, so feel free to check that out for a deeper understanding. Also, only ESP32 and ESP8266 boards are supported. In this video, we will look at two different scenarios. ESP32 as a MQTT broker, and we will connect it to the home network, that is our router, and all the devices will be connected to the same router. Another scenario in which ESP32 will work as hotspot, and all the devices will use ESP32 Wi-Fi access point to access the MQTT broker. Let's start with the first case. We will connect all the devices with our router and ESP32 will work as a MQTT broker. So for this scenario, we will use a smartphone and a Python script which will send random numbers and a Xiao ESP32 C3 which will work as a client and will send random numbers and a ESP32 which will use Pico MQTT library and work as a MQTT broker. Now the first thing that we are going to do is to program our broker on ESP32. The first thing, we will have to include the PicoMQTT.h library. If you don't have that library, you can go in the library manager and search for PicoMQTT, and you can download this library, PicoMQTT by Michael. And I am using the 1.1.1 version, but you might be able to download the latest version while doing this hands-on. Then the code begins by defining the Wi-Fi credentials you will need to connect to the network. Here Wi-Fi SSID is the name of the Wi-Fi network and Wi-Fi password is the password. The program uses these to connect to the Wi-Fi. Next, the code creates an instance of the Pico MQTT server class called MQTT, which will handle the MQTT communication. This line sets up the basic framework for our MQTT server. Now, let's move to the setup function. This is where the initial configuration happens when the microcontroller starts up. First, the serial communication is initialized with a baud rate of 115200. This is important for debugging and logging messages. Then the code tries to connect to the Wi-Fi network using the provided credentials. It repeatedly checks the connection status, pausing for a second in each loop until the connection is successful. Once connected, the device IP address is printed to the serial monitor, which can be helpful for connecting to the MQTT broker. Next, the code subscribes to all MQTT topics using the wildcard hash. It also sets up a callback function that will trigger whenever a message is received on any topic. Here, the callback function prints out the topic and the message payload so you can see exactly what's being received in real time. Finally, the MQTT begin function starts the MQTT server, preparing it to handle communication. Moving on to the loop function, which runs continuously after the setup function. Within the loop, the MQTT.loop function keeps the MQTT server running and responsive to incoming messages. There is also a small chance, 1 in 1000, that the device will publish a message to the Pico MQTT / welcome topic. And that's a quick overview of this code. Let's upload it to the ESP32. It is done uploading. Now I will open the serial monitor and you can see that connecting to Wi-Fi, it has connected and we got the IP address. On the right hand side, you can look at a Python client that sends a random number on topic Python in every 1 second. So if you would like to know how to use MQTT protocol in Python, I have created a detailed video on it. You can find the link in the description, but also you will be able to find this code in the description. So I'm not going to explain this code in detail now. So now let's run it. So you have to make sure that the IP address here is same in the code, and also you have to make sure that both your laptop and your ESP32 should be connected to the same network. So now let's run it. And we can see message in topic Python and there are some random numbers. Now let's stop this. And currently our broker is unauthenticated. So let's add authentication to this broker. For the authentication, we will first remove this object that we created using the Pico MQTT library. And then we will create a new class, which I have pasted here. So this class does the same thing which we were doing in the previous code, except we can put our own logic. So for example, if we look at in this class, we can see that there is a condition that the client ID length should be greater than 3. Otherwise, it will return an error. And next thing is, it will only accept connection if username and password are provided. Otherwise, it will give not authorized error. Another thing is here we have created two usernames and two passwords. And if client uses this alias and the secret password, he will be able to connect to the MQTT broker. So you can see we get a accepted message here. And otherwise, it should reject all other credentials and giving the error that either the username or password is wrong. So now let's upload this code. So now you can see that Wi-Fi is connected. IP address is the same. So now let's open the Python client and send some messages. So now we have to make few changes here since our broker is authenticated now. So I will add the username and password here. And also I will uncomment this line here. And now if I will run this code, I should get messages here. But what if I change the username like Alice456? Now what happens? Now we do not get a message here. So now let's add another client. So let's say, so I'm using this MQTT dashboard library. So first thing that I will do here is create a MQTT connection. I will click here. I will give here smartphone and the client ID is okay, and then I need the IP address. I will put the IP address here, 192.168.178.32, and the port number is okay. So then I'll go there in additional options and I will add the username here, Alice, and password secret, and I'll click here, and you see the tick mark, that means the connection is successful. Now I'll go to dashboards and I will create here a new dashboard. I will call it ESP32 dashboard, and I will click here. We'll click here. I will add something. Let's say we will add a text. I will say Python, and I will enable it. MQTT and MQTT connection is smartphone. Subscribe to topic. Yes, we will subscribe to the Python topic, and I think that's it. Design unit. We do not need a unit, so let's say, and so you see we are getting messages here, same messages here, and we can create a button here as well. Let's say number MQTT enable to the same, and we will publish a message. Let's say smartphone, and we can set a payload. We can say hello from smartphone. Now let's click it, and we get message from smartphone as well. So now I have added another ESP32 as well, ESP32 as MQTT client, for which I am using the PubSub MQTT library, and it is the same code that we have been using in our previous videos, but I will share the code in the description of this video as well. So now you see there are three clients connected to this broker, and this is working good so far. Let's push this, and we see a message from the smartphone as well. Hello from smartphone. We can show the message of ESP32 here as well. We can enable here, and we can subscribe to the ESP32 random topic MQTT connection, this one. And now you can see that we are getting message from ESP32 as well, Python as well. And if I will press this button, we publish a message from the smartphone. So that's it for this side. Now let's look at how we can use the ESP32 as an access point and then make the connection. Now let's explore a different scenario where the ESP32 acts as an access point, creating a local network. Other devices can then connect to this network and communicate with the MQTT broker running on the ESP32. We will use the same devices, smartphone, Python MQTT client, and Shao ESP32C3 MQTT client and ESP32 as a MQTT broker. So now let's look at how we can use ESP32 as an access point instead of using it as a Wi-Fi. So I will comment this code and I will paste the following code here. So you can see here Wi-Fi soft access point, and this will be the SSID of our hotspot, and this is the password, and then it will get the IP address and it will print the IP address. So we can upload this code. Once the code is uploaded, I can open the serial monitor, and now you can see the IP address is here. I forgot to remove this, but it doesn't matter for now. So this is the IP address. So now the first thing that we need to do is we have to be on the same network. So if I go to show available networks, you can see ESP32 hotspot here. So if I click here and I will connect here, it is connected. And now I can go back in my Python code, and now I will have to change the IP address here. I have to remove this, change the IP address here, and I have to run this code again. So you can see that I'm getting messages here, And now let's check it from the smartphone as well. So now you can see the messages in the app is not being updated because we haven't changed the IP address here. So we can go back to the MQTT connection smartphone and we will have to change the IP address here. And the tick mark shows that it is connected. Now we can go back to the dashboard and the messages are being updated here. So let's see, and we are able to send the messages from here. Similarly, we will have to change the IP address in the ESP32 MQTT client, which I haven't done. So that's why we are not able to get the messages from the ESP32 client. So that's it. Let's look at the performance of the library. The benchmark test consists of an ESP board in broker mode and a PC sending a large number of messages with different parameters. And the author of library has admitted, it doesn't have all the features that Mosquito has and it's much slower than a Raspberry Pi. He also admits, still if all you have is just a few devices which don't send tons of messages, Pico MQTT should be sufficient. He was able to use the library for his IoT projects, connecting a few ESPs, and so far it was very stable. In the end, I would like to mention about my book, which is now available on Amazon. If you are interested to learn more about ESP32 and build IoT project, check out this book. You can scan the QR code or the link is in the description. Finally, if you have any questions, feel free to write in the comments. And if you have any suggestions, please write that in comment as well. I'm open for discussion. And if you like this video, press the like button and share and subscribe for more such videos.